Today is November 13th, 1995. I'm interviewing Barbara Schubak. My name is Mildred Gelfand. This is Brooklyn, New York, USA. The language spoken will be English. Today is November 13th, 1995. I'm interviewing Barbara Schubak. My name is Mildred Gelfand. This is Brooklyn, New York, USA. The language spoken will be English. Could you say your name and spell it?
Right. My name is Barbara Schubak, S-C-H. My second name is S-C-H-U-B-A-K.
Are you known by any other names?
Yes, my other name, my maiden name is Bryna Drasnin, D-R-A-Z-N-I-N. I have also a nickname, Bubba, B-U-B-A.
Tell us a little bit about your nickname.
Well, in one of the concentration camps that we came was Blizhin, and all the people mostly speak Polish. And to call Bryna or Bronya, they couldn't pronounce it. And I was with a girl, her name was Luba. So they say, who is Luba, who is Buba? And this is the way it stays with me for all those years, for about 50 years.
How old are you?
I'm 70.
And what's your date of birth?
December 27, 1924.
1924,
yes,
okay.
Ma'am.
And where were you born?
I was born in Poland, Białystok. B-I-A-L-Y-S-T-O-K.
What part of Poland is Białystok?
It's the eastern part of Poland.
Near.
It's really like used to before the war, it was White Russia. And it's, I would say it's near the Russian border, like what it was.
Okay. Tell me about your family.
Well, my father died before the war when I was 3 years old. His name was Samuel. Samuel Drasnin.
Okay.
He was a blacksmith. He died when I was about 3 years old, and he married, my mother was his second wife, but it was also his sister-in-law. And they had eight children. My father had eight children.
And from
with my mother, from his first wife, that was my aunt. And with my mother, he had two children. My mother was much younger than my father, because before the war, women didn't work, and she helped her sister raise her children, so my father was a wealthy man, and they got married. And me and my sister was born, my younger sister, which was only about 2 years younger than me.
What was her name?
Her name was Hannah.
And tell me a bit about your mother.
My mother was a beautiful woman. She worked, she raised us. She never worked, and very devoted to us, and very beautiful woman. That's all I could say about my mother.
What was your mother's name?
My mother's name was Shana.
And you had half-sisters and brothers?
I had eight half-sisters and brothers. The names was Frumka, Masha, Razel, Peshki, then Enecha, then was Meshi, Zelik, and Yitzhak.
Do they live nearby?
They were all married, they were all much older than me, and nobody lived far away. It was considered in Poland a big town, but still nobody used cars or anything, you just walked nearby.
Did you have any grandparents, aunts, uncles?
No, aunts and uncles I had for my mother's side, not for my father's. Mm-hmm. My mother had three brothers, and she had three of sisters, one, but they all emigrated, most of them emigrated before the war, in the 30s, I would say. She had two sisters in England, which was Heike and Judith. She had one sister, Tziva, in the United States. She had one brother, Yossel, was in Palestine, and Meshi and Motel lived in Białystok.
Did she have another sister, too, your mother?
My mother had another sister, Frumka, which lived in Białystok, near us, in a walking distance.
Could you tell me something about your religious background?
Well, my parents, my mother, my family, my brothers were Orthodox Jews. We belonged to a shul, and we had a kosher home. And we observed Shabbos and holidays.
Did you attend school?
I attended a Jewish school, not a Hebrew school, a Jewish school. The schools were from the Bund, was like a workman's organization, and it was a Jewish school. We spoke Yiddish, but also Polish, and a little bit of Hebrew. I went there to finish 7 grades, 5 in one school, Michalevich School, and 2 grades in another school, but it was on the same level. I graduated in 1937.
Did you belong to any organization?
Yes, I certainly did. I belonged because I went to a workman's school, which was supported from the Bund. I belonged to a youth organization from Bund, which is called SCIF.
And what was the focus of that organization?
The Bund organization was an organization that they taught us to have a good life in the country that we lived, which meant in Poland, to have a good life, to adjust to living there. And that was their theory.
Did you work at all before the war?
Yes, in 1937, when I finished school, my mother's sister-in-law, which my brother Martel's wife, was a dressmaker, and she taught me a little bit of dressmaking. I didn't care too much, but I stayed on because I could have used the couple of slotters that I made. I also taught some children, and that was about it.
Mm-hmm. What were your interests before the war?
Well, I belonged to a choir, singing. I like to sing, and sports. And as a matter of fact, from the organization, we used to sing at rallies for the Bund. And it was, for a young girl, it was pretty good life.
What else do you remember about Bialystok?
Well, Bialystok was a town, it was an industrial town. They made materials, weavers, a lot of weavers. And it was a Jewish town. What I mean Jewish is mostly in Poland in the city, they spoke Polish. We spoke Yiddish. And people were trying to make a living, tailors and shoemakers and blacksmiths. Nobody was very wealthy. It was a life like in any other city in Poland.
And what were the relationships like with the local Polish people?
Well, we were afraid of them all the time. Very much afraid of them. We knew there was anti-Semitism, and we tried to stay out of each other's way. My next-door neighbor, which had the fruit, the trees over us, we got along, but we still knew in our heart that they were not friends to us.
How did you know that?
Because every time you could hear is Jew, Jew, Jew. It sounds worse in Polish, where it said Żyd. And the way you say it, it's not like you're Jewish or you're, but Żyd was not a nice saying.
What do you remember about the start of World War II, September 1939?
Well, as a young girl, and I like life, I like singing, I like dancing, we didn't think too much, but we heard rumors, war, because we knew Hitler was right next door to us. So we knew something was going on. Everybody was preparing for war. And we knew something is going to happen. We didn't know what. But we thought that Poland was strong enough to defend themselves. But all of a sudden, here was war, and there was not too much. And in no time, we had the Germans. Like overnight, the Germans came into our town.
What happened then?
When the Germans came in, and I'm just saying the Germans came in, it took us a little while to digest that they're coming, that they're here. Because knowing already what they did in Germany, we knew that no good is going to come.
When what did you know about Germany?
We knew about Germany that Hitler was a bad man, he was a Jew hater, that he chased out all the Jewish, the influential Jewish people from Germany, like Einstein, and we knew that it wasn't good. We had papers. Bialystok was a cultural city. We had a lot of newspapers, and we knew what was going on, even though there was no television and very, very few radios in our town. But reading the papers, we knew that no good is going to come. The first week they marched in, they started shooting at random, whoever came in their sight. And this continued like for a couple of days, and all of a sudden, again the rumors that the Germans is going to leave and Russia is going to come in. And it was like nobody believed it. Nobody could believe that something as good is going to happen. Not that we were so crazy about communism, but just to get rid of the Germans was good enough. And good enough, one day the Germans marched out and the Russian army moved in. We were standing there with flowers. It was like a miracle. It was beautiful for a young person like me. That was also, it was a life of no worries for a while. I got a job. I started going to school at night to learn Russian. And I got a job. A cousin of our family owned a vineyard, made wine. And I got a job there, but about later, the Russians nationalized that wine factory. And I worked there in the daytime, and I went to school at night. And life was beautiful.
What did you do for recreation?
Recreation, again, I belonged to a dancing, folk dancing group, and to a big choir, with a very big, and we used to go to concert. And we just worked, and we went out like any young girl, worked out with boys and friends, and we weren't thinking about anything else. But there was always the shadow of Germany, because we were so near the German border. We knew something is gonna come. Something is gonna come. And we were waiting for them, like, but I wouldn't say that 100% every day that occupied my mind, because as I said, I love to sing and I like to dance and I like to go out with my friends. One day we went like, skiing, not on mountains.
Cross country
skiing. And we passed by, was a group of us, and we passed by the factory where I worked. And the Russians had a way, they said, they used to call it Pyatuletka, the five-year plan. In those 5 years, you have to make so much and so much, produce so much and so much. The wine factory did not do too good. So we stopped in the wine factory just to get a drink of water. I don't remember what it was. And I saw the filters. Wine has to be filtered to come out clear. And I saw that the filters were empty, and automatically I just filled in those filters. So what happened was that the next day we doubled our amount of product, what we made, we doubled. So for that I got 2 weeks to go to Leningrad. My mother was afraid to let me go because I never left home by myself.
How old were you at the time?
Well, I would say about 15, maybe close to 16 time. But I went with another girl that also won for something else. And as we were driving to go into Lani Katana train, I was in a car with high military men. And then we passed by certain places near Leningrad. One of the officers says to me, look out the window. If war broke out, and he said, and it will, this is where the Germans are going to have their final thing, whatever you could call it. He says, like Bonaparte, like Napoleon, got his downfall here. This is when it's going here too. I always remember those words.
What did he mean by that?
He said, because there were, Everglades, where there's water you don't see. Oh. Is it Everglades?
Yeah.
This is what we pass by, a lot of them, he says. And if they're going to be down in the winter, this is going to be their death. And then we saw the pictures at the end of the war of the Germans laying there. I always remember the words from those captains. In Leningrad, I had a wonderful time. I met a lot of people who went to see all the palaces of Nikolai the Tsar and Catherine the Great. We had a beautiful time. And I had a lot of pictures taken with a lot of people, and I came back home. And it didn't take about 2 weeks that war broke out. The Germans attacked Bialystok, Russia, which is Bialystok. Our city was the nearest, because the trains, they told us that the last train in the pact that Stalin made with Hitler was, they're going to get, for peace, they're going to get coal and all kind of raw material that they needed for war. So the last train left Bialystok about 2 hours before they attacked. They let the train all go through and they attacked Bialystok.
What day was that date?
It was June 1941. And I looked out the window by me and I heard cannons and I had bombs. And everybody was running and we said, what is it? And everybody said, it's maneuvers. Maneuvers? What do you call them? When they know really war, but they're just playing war.
Maneuvers.
Maneuvers. My brother had two officers living in his apartment. And I came down and I said to them, what's happening? And they said, don't worry.
That was nothing. The Russians.
Russians. They said nothing. An hour later, they came back and they said to me, it is war. Germany attacked Russia. And this is when our hell started.
What do you remember about the attack?
I remember one thing. The Germans came in about a week later, as they attacked, when they started the war, they came to Bialystok. The minute they came in, the first day, they came to the Jewish sector of our town. We had a beautiful, beautiful synagogue with a dome, beautiful. The best of cantors used to come to sing in that synagogue. They picked out about 1,500 healthy, young men, only men. And they threw in grenades and they burned the synagogue to the ground. The next day all we saw was ashes. The shooting was like no stop. They were shooting at random. Anybody that came into the site. They were mad because when they left, we weren't as nice to them as we were nice to the Russians, to the Russian army. And they just gave us hell. This continued like this maybe for a couple of days, the shooting and the killing and the hitting. Then the next step was they closed up streets, the Jewish streets. They took like Sunday, Saturday, and Thursday. We called them Shabbos-diki, Sonntag-diki, and Thursdays. They picked out the men, and they took them away. When they came on a Sunday to our section, they closed up the streets, and they came to our house. And they took my brothers, two brothers. One was sick in bed. His name was Yitzhak. He had a bunion infection and he couldn't get up. And they came and they took him out, and they took my other brother and my little niece, must have been about 5 years old, said to the German, "Don't take my father, he's so sick." And he kicked her with his boot. And the little girl was such a beautiful little girl. They also took away my aunt Frumka that lived in a Polish, most in a Polish neighborhood. She came to be safe by us with three sons. They took away her two sons and one that's still living now in Florida. He was about 10, 11 years old. And the Germans said to him, "Hide yourself." And he is the only one of the males that was in our house that is alive today.
What happened to them?
They kept telling us that they were taken for work, for labor, slave labor. But later on we find out they were all shot. My brother, the one with the bunion, with the sick foot, he was shot about a couple of miles away. This was, we heard from Polish people that saw him laying there. We couldn't even go to take him, to bury him. The next step was the yellow stars that we had to wear. And the shooting never stopped. A couple of weeks later, they gave us about 24 hours to go into the ghetto. The ghetto was in another part of town. There was only buildings, no fields, no nothing. Nothing for food. We were a family. It was me, my mother, and my younger sister, and another sister. And we were five people and two little children. And we moved in to an uncle's. My mother's brother lived in the place, in the streets where the ghetto was. They gave everybody about a meter for every person. They were five already, and we moved in with them, because if it wasn't us, it would have been somebody else.
How did you get from your house to the
ghetto?
We
took whatever we could carry and a little wagon that we were pulling, a little wagon. And this is what we just took, whatever we could take, because there was no more men to help us. We moved into my brother, to my uncle's house. And I knew if I'm not going to do something, we're going to starve. There was no food. We couldn't take any food from the house, because a couple of weeks already, until we went into the ghetto, there was no food no more. We couldn't go shopping, we couldn't do anything. So in the ghetto, somehow, I was the one that I had to go out and see what I can do for food. So I went to the Judenrat, and I went into myself into a group for slave labor. And they took us like in an army base, about a few miles, 5 or 6 miles from the ghetto, maybe a little bit more. They took us there with the SS, and I worked by peeling potatoes, peeling carrots. And for that, they gave me some food to take home. I brought food for my family, but because the food wasn't kosher, my mother did not touch anything of that kind of food. All through the ghetto, my mother never touched non-kosher food. She lost every tooth in her mouth. All she could eat was bread, what I could exchange for something that was kosher to eat. The ghetto was a place where you lived every day in fear. Whenever the Germans wanted, they came in. Now I'm going to say that ghetto was not like Bedford-Stuyvesant or Harlem. It was a ghetto with armed SS at the gate. You couldn't go in, you couldn't go out. The only one that could do it was the SS. Whenever they felt like, they came in and they shoot and they robbed. They asked, because they took so many men, they used to come to the Judenrat, and they said, if you'll give us so many pounds of gold, if you give us so many leather, so many things, a pianos, they're gonna let your men come. Never happened. But even though we gave, everybody gave their marriage ring, everybody gave away anything they had for that. And one day, the job that I had at the army closed down, and I was left without work again. So a couple of days later, again I went to the gate by the Judenrat, and again I went into a group. I think it was about 100, maybe 100 women that they took to the train station. Because we were so near by the border, the Germans did not trust the Polish workers at the trains, the train workers. So they brought in their own, but we had to clean up the building for them, the quarters for them to live. So the group that we went was with like with one piece of paper which the SS carried for the whole group. So we couldn't go any place. You had to go from work to work. When we cleaned up all the rooms, at the end of about a week or maybe 2 weeks, they selected just a few of us. I don't remember how many, if it's 5 or 10 girls. And everybody was had about 2 or 3 rooms to clean. And everybody had individual people. And the good thing about it was that we got from them, from the workers, from the Germans, individual papers. That meant that we could go in and out of the ghetto on our own.
Take two. Today is November 13th, 1995. I'm interviewing Barbara Schubak. My name is Mildred Gelfand. This is Brooklyn, New York, USA. The language is English. You were talking about being given individual identification papers.
Let me tell you something about this. When I say cleaning rooms, today, if somebody like you, maybe somebody, cleaning rooms, it's not such a nice profession. That was something, your lifesaver. People in the ghetto would give anything, anything, the most expensive jewelry, if they had dollars, if they had zlotys, they would give for that. Because it gave you a chance to go out of the ghetto by yourself. And if you went out of the ghetto, you got in contact with the peasants, with the Polish people, where the food was. This is where the bread and the flour, nothing grew in the ghetto. They had everything.
You're talking about the papers being valuable.
Absolutely. The most valuable paper in the whole, I would say for me at that time, was the most valuable paper all through the war years. Because I went out of the ghetto and I got in touch with some Polish people. I exchanged for boots. I used to take out our clothes, some little things that were still there, a ring for my sister-in-law, and bring him food. Sometimes it was good to bring in, I went through good. Sometimes DSS at the gate used to frisk you, what did you say?
Frisk
you and take everything away and get even beat up. I had one of those experiences.
You want to describe
my mother and my sister used to wait by the gate every day when I came from work. And when I came in, I had some saccharin that was very valuable in the ghetto, hidden in like a girdle. And when they touched me, those packages fell out and I got beat up by the SS. By that time, getting this kind of punishment was already a common thing. The next day we did the same thing. I worked for a German, one of the Germans was a socialist. And he kept saying to me, I should stay alive, that the war is lost. You're really gonna, just if you stay alive, you're gonna make it. As I work in the railroad, I had a lot of, some of the girls that worked, that lived on the Irish side, means on the Polish side, as Polish girls, and they worked for the underground. We came in touch with them. Sometimes they took our papers, they go into the ghetto to speak with the leaders in the ghetto that were planning an uprising, and they used to come back. And what can I say? The ghetto was the ghetto. We got used to our lives, the shootings and the Germans. One day, the German that I worked for said to me, you know, I saw a lot of trucks. I passed by the ghetto gate and I saw there's some things going on there. I don't know what. I said, you know what? Maybe you should stay overnight. So me and a few girls that worked there, we stayed in an attic.
In the railroad?
In by the railroad station where they lived, there was an attic, and we stayed there overnight. The next morning, we decided, no matter what is in the ghetto, we're going to go there. I wanted to be with my mother and my family. What good is it to be by yourself? I had to stay with them. So he took us to the ghetto. He gave something probably to the SS, because otherwise they would have said, where were you? What did you do? And we went into the ghetto. They took out some people from the ghetto. Where they took them, we don't know. But they took away our paper. We couldn't go out of the ghetto no more by ourselves. I want to bring one incident. I forgot, but I'm going to say it. Our good neighbors, the Polish people that lived next door, the minute we went into the ghetto, they went into our house. One day, I was short, I had blonde hair and blue eyes, and I looked like exactly not Jewish. So I covered with a kerchief my yellow star. And because our house was not too far from the railroad station, I just had to make one turn. The law was you could only walk from the ghetto one way to your workplace. You could not be found anyplace else with your individual paper. But I took a chance. Why? Because my brother had a lot of tools. Some of them were mechanics, and they had a lot of tools. So all I wanted to take out is some tools and sell it for bread. The minute I came to my house, which I risked my life to be there, my good neighbor opened the door, and and she says to me, you're a Jew, you get away from here because I'm going to call the Germans on you. And I just, until today, I have to say it, even if it sounds maybe very bad. When somebody said, oh, she's better than, she's my neighbor, she's not Jew, but she's very, very good. I cannot take this thing.
This was a woman that you were friendly with?
I would say, you must understand that a house in Poland, if you had a house, You just didn't change the neighborhood because the house, the neighborhood, nothing changed. Everything stayed. My house must have been there before I was born, maybe how many years. It's still there. And that neighbor, we used to go to the weddings and to the, they used to borrow money for my brothers. The trees, the apple trees and pear trees came over on our side. And if this woman could say to me, just a couple of, must have been maybe a month already, if you're not going to get away from here, I'm going to call the Germans. That was very hard to take. But
how did you react to that?
Nothing. I just walked away to my job. Nothing. I didn't do any. There's nothing. Any Polish kid, we had to walk in the middle of the street. You could not walk on the sidewalks with the yellow star. Any little Polish kid that was a nothing, any prostitute that was a nothing, could spit in our faces and throw rocks at us. This is what it was. So what could I, little bit like this, she told me, Jew. So I went to my work, and this is what happened. But I jumped in the middle because then, as I said, the ghetto was closed already. We couldn't, it wasn't closed completely, but on an individual paper, you could no more go out of the ghetto. Unless you were like my husband, which he worked for the Gestapo as a mechanic, but like cleaning woman and all these that were, we couldn't go out. So again, we had a problem with food. That was always the thing, is food. Where do you get food? Where do you eat? Where do you see your mother? You don't want to see your mother hungry. You don't want to see the kids hungry, little kids. So it was, again, my sister was, the younger sister was afraid to go out of the house, was very much afraid. So it's again, I was the one elected. So I find out that a group of people are going, they were teachers. That I find out they're going about a couple of miles from Bialystok, from the city, to dig potatoes. And you get potatoes for your work. Now, money was not involved ever, it was only food. I said, my God, I'm going to bring potatoes, it's going to be good. So we worked and we slept in a basement that was wet. We worked there for a couple of weeks, but I got potatoes and I got wood and I got some other things, I think beets. And when I came home with all that, it was like finding, what would I say today to compare to that? I don't think nothing. If I would find a diamond now, would you eat a diamond? But the food that I brought for my family was everything. That didn't take long again because it was only a couple of weeks. And as you saw in Schindler's List, if you worked in the ghetto, you had a better chance to survive. So the industrialists, German industrialists, they built factories in the ghetto. There was a factory from a kneading factory, a uniform factory, and was also a shoe factory, and it was a felt factory. Felt is to make the felt to make warm shoes for the Germans, because by that time they were already deep in Russia and it was very cold. I think it must have been the year, let's see, 19, and the end of 1942. And the end of 1942. So I worked in that factory. It was like a big table. Like the table was like a steam table. And you worked from little pieces like of material, of wool. And you worked it on the steam. And that made that felt very hard. And this was the hard felt that they used for boots for the German soldiers. We worked, my sister didn't work, I'm skipping something with my sister. It was a time before that they said all the girls that do not work in the ghetto are going sent out to a city, Baranovich was also, but it's already out of Bialystok. My mother was hysterical. where is she going to go, a girl by herself? So one of the Germans, what I said that is a social, he gave her, he took out a paper for her. He risked also a lot. He gave her a paper and she stayed with the family. But every good thing comes to an end, and that was one of those things. We worked in the factory, and in February 1943, all of a sudden, in the middle of the night, we saw the factory that I worked with, worked in, was near the gates from the ghetto. And everybody comes back and they say that a lot of trucks and German tanks are at the ghetto gate. And we knew no good is gonna come, so we ran out. And I got my mother and my sister in the factory with me. And I hid her in this, under the table from the steam. Because only the ones that had papers were, could stay there. Early in the morning, a group of Germans came in and they asked, is there anybody without a paper? We didn't say nothing. They looked at the tables and I thought, any minute they're going to take my mother out. But they didn't look so deep and she was there. When they left, I thought for sure they must have been suffocated from the heat. But the Almighty God helped them and they were alive. Little by little, I was afraid to take them out because I was afraid of the people that I worked with, because they said for every woman that you're going to find, three of the workers are going to be shot. In the meantime, we knew that the Germans went through every house in the ghetto and they took out people from no ages, children, women, and men. Some of the people, the old people, the religious people, walked with a talisman man through the ghetto. And they took out 20,000 people from the ghetto on trucks, and they took him. We now know it was in Treblinka. In that group, there are my sisters, my stepsisters with their children. My brother, one of them, the other two were already shot before. They took him out from a, he built himself like a hiding place. They took them all out. When we came out, we couldn't find anybody. My mother was devastating. Nobody was there no more. That time, they made the ghetto already smaller because so many people.
Just to go back a little bit, you talked about another incident with a gentleman, Malamud.
Yes.
That you wanted to talk about.
We find out when we came out because we didn't know too much when we were in the ghetto, when we were in the factory. There was a man with his family. He used to work before the war at paint, in a paint store. And he knew everything about paint and all these things. And when they came to take him and his family out, he threw acid in the face of one of the Germans. And the German that couldn't see that shot one of his SS man himself because he couldn't see where he was shooting, and that his name was Melamed, and he ran away. And the Germans took 10 or 15 people, I don't remember, and they shot them all. And they said they're going to, every day, they're going to shot as many as people as they want until he gives himself up. And he did give himself up. And they shot him and they hanged him, and he was hanging almost a week in the ghetto.
Did you see that?
I saw him hanging, yes. Until his body started to fall apart, he was hanging there, then they took him down. My sister, by that time, also got a job in that factory, and we worked also for the bread that we used to get. If you worked, you got some you got bread and whatever you could find any place to survive. And this continued like this for until August 16, 1943. By that time already we heard rumors that were gas chambers, slave camps, because we thought until now that my sisters, all of them that were taken away, were just for labor. Maybe they went just to work in working camps. Maybe we wanted to believe in it. Maybe I mean my mother, maybe we hoped they were not taken to the dead.
How did you hear of that?
From the Polish underground, from the Jewish people that were on Jewish and Christian papers that lived outside the ghetto. Rumors.
We're just to talk about the underground, the resistant movement. What was some of their activities in the ghetto?
Well, we didn't know too much because we were afraid, but we knew there mostly those people were from Zionist organizations, from the Betar, Chalutz, young people, and they said they're not going to go, they're going to fight. They didn't have too much ammunition. There was no way of bringing in. There was nobody to help. The Polish people did not help us if you went out to the ghetto to run away someplace. They called the Germans on you. There was no place to go for us. People say, how did you go like lambs to the slaughter? There was no place to go. If you run away someplace and you go outside and there's your enemy outside. The enemy was inside, the enemy was outside, there was no place to run. So you stayed. And then you didn't want to believe what's happening.
And then what happened?
So, in August 1943, the Germans gave, there was leaflets. Everybody out of the houses, you take just what you could. And we were running, not walking, running to the street from the ghetto with the Germans on all sides, running to a place out of the city. It's called Pietraszyk. I don't remember how many miles, about 5 or 6, maybe 7 miles. All I know that we were running, being chased, not walking, running.
What time of day was this?
It was in the morning. And the whole ghetto was running. They took us to a place, Pietraszyk, a big field, tremendous field. And we stayed there a whole night with the German SS all around us. We knew that we're going someplace, but we still thought we're going maybe to a working camp. In the morning, the SS came. And they put us like in a row. We were running like cattle that you see today. In cattle, when you have to take cattle out, you run. And the Germans were on both sides with their sticks, with their whips, and with their guns. And they kept saying, right, left, right, left. You didn't know what is right, what is left, where you're going. All I know that I was sent to the right, my mother and my sister were sent to the left, and I wanted to go with them. Life was no meaning no more. No meaning. Chased me right back. They put us on trains, cattle trains, like you saw the Schindler's List. Was it really exactly what it was? It was hot. It was in August, it was very hot. No water, no toilet facilities, nothing. It was just a little window in the train. Very small. And as we were rolling along, one of the men in our train, in our car, jumped, I don't know, they pushed, somebody helped them push out from the window, that little window, and it was shut. And on the trains, on top of the trains, were the SS riding with us. And they stopped the train and they shot in the train. And a couple of people were shot dead. Not dead, but wounded. The blood was all over the place. Their crying of the pain was unbelievable. We begged as we were driving around for a couple of hours and we came to our station. And we asked the Polish, outside the Polish train workers, where are we? And he said, Treblinka, and he made the sign on his throat, on the throat, that this is for the dead. We begged them for water. People gave money. They never brought anything. People were drinking their own urine in the trains. The heat was just unbearable. We stayed on that station for a couple of hours. Later on, we find out that because of Treblinka, they couldn't accommodate so many. They took some of the cars, and the rest they sent back. I was the lucky one that my car was sent farther on. I guess by that time that my mother, my sister, was not trained to Treblinka, because otherwise I would have seen them in the other places where I was taken. After a couple of hours of driving, of riding, they took us to a place named Majdanek. It's near Lublin.
In Poland.
Poland, it was all in Poland. Poland was the place because it was such an anti-Semitic country. They couldn't have done it in any other places, just in Poland. There was enough place, and this is because they helped them. The Polish people helped the Germans. I have a hatred for them more than for the Germans, because they helped. We came to Majdanek. And we find some Polish prisoners of war. And they said to us, if you're going to be here, it's not bad because we have no gas chambers and no crematoriums. But if they're going to put you on trucks and take you a couple of miles from here, you should know this is for the dead. In the meantime, they took away every money, a gold, a rings, whatever you had, they took it away from you. That was the first thing. The second thing what they did, separate men from the women. Women with children, and women without children. And that was, I'm not going to get into the tragedy of the children that we thought, some people thought, that if you're going to survive without children, but it hurts too much to talk about it, and I'm not going to talk about it now. It was very bad. At that time, I thought the earth should open and all of us should just fall in of that incident with the children. But they did not. So they put us all on trucks. And who was there? The guards, the Ukrainians, and Muslims, that the whole world, I have to put it in, that the whole world is trying to save them, those Muslims from Bosnia, they were our enemies there. They were our SS, those Bosnians, those Muslims from there. I have to say it. Maybe somebody's going to read it. I'm going to put something that is Sephardic, the other ones, what do they call the other Yugoslavian now? The Serbs?
Serbs.
They were the ones that were good to us. But I'm not in politics now. All I want to talk is my own story.
Right. Right.
They took us on trucks, and they took us a couple of miles down. This is where it was, the crematorium and the gas chambers. They kept us a whole night because it was already evening, outside in the fields. The next morning, they took us to showers. Some of them were the guests, some of them were regular showers. I was the lucky one to go into regular showers. By the next morning, I saw some people that I knew, parents of friends of mine, the older people, they were taken on stretchers. Because the crematorium was not built yet, they just buried them on an open place, which was just covered up, not to be seen, like what we knew what it was. That crematorium was being built. We stayed there, we went to examination. In the vagina, and all to our bodies, in the ears and all over. They took away our clothes, they just gave us some old things, no underwear, no nothing. And we knew that that was the place that we have to run away from. So one day, it used to be, we call it a sailor pail. What is a sailor pail? Yes.
This is tape 3. Today is November 13th, 1995. I'm interviewing Barbara Schubak. My name is Mildred Gelfand. This is Brooklyn, New York, USA. The language is English. We were talking about the tse lapel.
Right.
Yeah.
I just want to explain what it is.
Right.
Tse lapel is from the name of tseon. It means like counting. Twice a day, they used to take us out to be counted, so nobody escaped. This was, I just want to explain what a tse lapel is. Tse lapel was also, at that time, they used to, if you didn't look good, if you got skinny, if you had some boils on your face, on your body, they took you away to the crematoriums. This particular place, that tse lapel, they said they need 200 dressmakers. And because I knew that I had to get away from there, this was the place where that crematorium was, the guest chamber was in your face. So then the SS woman said, everybody pushed themselves in. I don't know what had happened to me, but as many a time as I tried to go in, she threw me out. But like somebody put an arm on my back and pushed me in again. I don't remember how many times I pushed myself in, and finally I was in that group. They took 200 women and about 1,000 men from Majdanek. And they took us on a train. A couple of hours ride, a place called Blizhin. Blizhin was a camp, slave camp. It was like for working. There was no guest chambers there and no crematoriums there.
When did you get to Blizhin?
We got to Blizhin probably, 1943, probably in August, probably at the end of August, or maybe beginning, but the end of August, because the 16th, they took us out, and at the end, probably by the end of August. They took us to Blizhin. Blizhin was a camp. They had factories there. They made uniforms for the Germans and kneadings. But there was no, the food was terrible. No food. Very dirty. No medicines, no absolutely nothing. We came into the Bialystok, group of girls came into a place where there were people already from before, from Jewish people that was at war from 1939, like from western part of Poland. They built for us in the middle of the room, like from wood to sleep, like in the middle. It was on both sides there, we called it preachers. And we slept in the middle unbought. There was no clothes, the clothes that we wear, no underwear. We had to find something and try to put on whatever we could. They cut our hair, shaved our heads. The kapos, the Germans, were hitting. You could see every day people get swollen from hunger. You could know, you could see them every day were dying out. After I was 1 week in Blizhin, I had a terrible dysentery with blood. I fainted and they picked me up and they took me to that hospital. The hospital was a barn and you were laying on the floor on earth. On one side men and the other side women. There was no medicines, no nothing. But a friend of mine that I was close to in Bialystok, she burned a portion of bread because they said that burned bread is good for dysentery. I stayed there for a while, for 8 days. I probably lost a lot of weight because there was no food and I was very dehydrated. So I was a whole night, all the time I was just a little water. There was no water, nobody gave you water, cold water. And maybe it's gonna sound a little silly to some people, but I had a dream and my mother gave me cold water to drink. I felt the water on my mouth. As I said, maybe some people is gonna think, what is she talking about? What that mother gives you to drink? But I had water on my mouth. I felt a little better and my friend came and she says to me, listen, we're going to take you out because we heard they're going to take out all the sick people from that place. She took me out of the hospital and they, in the morning, what did say, lapel? They kept me in the middle because we used to stay like five in a row. So they put me in the middle so I wouldn't fall down and have the support to hold me. Somehow I have a friend also from Bialystok, he worked in the kitchen. And I'm going to mention his name. His name is Ben Rich.
Ben Rich?
Ben Rich. He worked in the kitchen. And he took me in the kitchen a couple of days a week to work. When he worked in the kitchen, he had potatoes, raw potatoes, some whatever they had from food, we ate. And I came to my strength. And I worked in a factory there from uniforms. We made white uniforms for the soldiers, for the German soldiers, because by that time they were fighting in Stalingrad and Leningrad, and there was a lot of snow, so they needed those white uniforms not to be recognized in their green uniforms. And we worked 12 hours a day, night shifts and day shifts. But in that time in between, I had typhus fever. And that was worse than anything, that the pain in stomach and head. The temperature, but today I would say probably about 104, 105. But nobody took any temperatures. Again, I was in the same hospital again. I remember there's a Dr. Citron that lives now in Israel, and I knew him from Bialystok. And when he passed by, and he was crying, and he said, I cannot, there's nothing to give you. People were dying in the hundreds every day from yellow fever, from the typhus. I'm going to say the story again and again. I felt water in my mouth, and I felt my mother. I dreamed my mother gave me soda. My temperature started to go down. I went out of the hospital. When I went out of the hospital, we had a lady, like, I would say the manager of the floor. I don't know how what to say today. We called it a black eldester.
Black eldester.
Yeah. She had a little room by the barrack where we stayed, but she had a room all for herself, a little room. Her husband worked outside with Polish people. And he had a lot of food. And because I had already the typhus fever and I couldn't get it no more, so he asked me to take care of her because she was sick. So in the meantime, I had her portions of food that she couldn't eat and also extra food that her husband gave me. So I started getting a little better, but that doesn't take too long. All of a sudden I had boils and all kind of funguses on my hand and a terrible boil under my arm. The boil under my arm was as big as an egg. I couldn't even no more close my arm. There was a doctor there, but if you went with them with these kind of things, he cut with dirty things. And whoever went to him either died. I was crippled. So I had an acquaintance of mine from Bialystok, and she used to be a nurse, and she said to me, don't go there. Take your own urine and a piece of cotton, anything, and keep it under your arm as long as you can. The pains from that boil was just unbelievable. I have no words to prescribe what it was. But in keeping the urine under my arm, that boil busted. And even after that, she said to me, keep the urine, this would disinfect your wound under your arm. But with all those things that you had to go in every day to work. There was no such thing unless you were laying down. You had to go to work. So we worked and we made us uniforms. And one day they said a whole bunch of those white coats that we made, that we sabotaged, and it came back from the front with lice in it. And it was in that room, a whole mountain full of those coats we had to fix.
What did they think you did to the coats?
We didn't make, the sleeves didn't fit in the right place. We don't even know what it was. We didn't know what it was. I don't know who sabotaged it because we were afraid. I don't know what it was. We don't know what it was. All I know, this is what they said, and they said for punishment, the women are going to get 25 lashes and the men 50 lashes. And they're going to do it in the morning shift. That time, I worked in a night shift, but we were afraid. We saw the girls coming in, black and blue, crying. But my time came. I had to go into the morning shift. We came in, and about a couple hours later, in the morning, the SS came in, the Gestapo, and they told us to go to the end of the room. And one after the other, like in a row, one after the other. And when it came to the girl, to that time, they had to bend down and they get the lashes. The screaming went to heaven. probably didn't go to heaven because nobody did anything to help us. Somehow was an end of the of that line, and I saw that mountain of coats, and I never thought about it, I'm going to do it. I didn't think about it. It was just like, and the moment I went and I hid myself in that mountain of coats with all the lies, I was laying there. I didn't know that somebody else was there too. For a while, I'm thinking, God, they're going to catch me here. Why did I have to do it? They only get lashes. I'm probably going to be shot. But it was too late to go out. I was laying there. And I heard him saying, if I'll find anybody hiding, I'm going to be shot. Now, I felt the rifle pushing in and out in that mountain of clothes. But I couldn't go out. Now when it was all quiet, because the minute you got a lashes, you had to go outside. So when nobody was there, it was all quiet, I was still afraid to go out. I was afraid not only for the Germans, I was afraid of my own people there. Because I risked their lives too. I came out, also made myself crying, and because I was afraid. This happened, this is one time when we were working at night, there was a foreman, he was Jewish, but he was an ugly man. I still remember his nails. He had like funguses all over his nails, like terrible nails. He was an ugly looking man. We had some people, police, the Jewish police, that had a nice life, I'm not saying good life, but they had food. The main thing was what? Food. If you had enough food. How did he hang it? The food was the main thing. If you had food, you could exist. You could live through it. So those guys, the police, had a lot of food. If you have a lot of food, you want something else. You want sex. So there was girls. They had lovers. But the work had to be done. So they bought the foreman. They went away with the girls at night, and we had to do the work. The thing was, if you finished your work, you had to make so many coats. If you finished it early, on time, you could put your head down and close your eyes. Because I was so sick and so weak after typhus, I had boils all over my body later on, not as big under my arm, but a lot of boils and a lot of fungus that itched. I had terrible pains in my rectum from hemorrhoids, from the sicknesses. So I was so tired, no food, no medicines, that I was hoping to close my eyes. And here he used to come every night and give us more work. So one day I said to him, listen, I'm not going to do it again. You could do anything you want, but I'm not going to work no more. I can't. So a couple of days later, it was a sailor pill. And all of a sudden, I heard my number. I had my number. We all had numbers.
What type of numbers?
It was just written on a piece of something, a plastic. It wasn't plastic. It was something, a number you wear on your neck. It was from some kind of material.
It was not on your arm.
No, those camps, but you had to remember that number. Because if they called you, it was only by number. All of a sudden on the telephone, they called me. They called all people, they called a group of 80, maybe 100 women and men. And then they took you out on a telephone for a transport. Any place. It was not for good things. Because every camp sent out the worst, the sick one, the crippled one, if they had. So everybody knew that I was a goner. My friends that I knew from Bialystok, very close friends, one smuggled in a diamond, which I helped her from Majdanek. She gave somebody her diamond, the diamond, to let me stay. They took the diamond away, never sent out. But as always, I am a very deep believer in God. I'm not so much of a do everything, but I believe deeply. And God was good to me. They sent us to a camp. It was near Radama, but I would say about 30 miles from Blushin, something like that.
Near Radom?
Near Radom. I cannot tell distances, but it was a couple of hours of in a truck, open truck. They took us there to a place that was heaven compared to all the places I was until then.
What? When did you leave?
It must have been by August, not August. Yeah, August 1944. Must have been, no, before that, must have been April. Yeah, but April 1944, right? Because that was the time, because we worked on a field, was a Polish landowner. It was as big as Rockefeller.
What was the name of the town?
Sucha. The place of the camp, it was not a camp, it was a town, Sucha. And he was a Polish landowner. He was called a prince. He was from royalty, Polish royalty. And he owned acres and acres and acres of land. And the Germans needed the food. So they took us to work the fields. He gave us extra food, milk. He gave us, and we ate whatever it grew on the fields. Raw potatoes and raw carrots, and there were trees with apples and cherries, and we ripped them off even though it wasn't ripe yet. We ate whatever we saw, we ate. And the sun, we unbuttoned ourselves, our uniforms. Vidya says they let us do it. And the sun and the extra food, the milk, did a lot of good. All my boils disappeared. I gained some weight. We had fresh water, we had cold water to wash ourselves. To sleep, we slept in a barn and hay, but it was clean. All the lice, all the funguses, everything disappeared. There was a girl there working with me, another woman in the fields. Her husband was Polish, she was Jewish, so she was sent into the ghetto, into the camps. And her husband somehow followed her around, because it was all near. He was from Radom, it was all near. So he used to buy the SS, gave him something, cigarettes or whatever, because they didn't have too much themselves no more. And he used to get food to her. But the girl, this lady, was very slow in working. And she used to get punished all the time from the SS. They used to beat her up. So when I'm fast, though, when I used to finish my work, I used to go back and help her, and she shared the food with me. And that was also very good. That was all. And all felt me, so we stayed, we worked like this until, till the Russians started to attack in Poland. They started going after the Germans. And the Germans did not want to leave any traces of camps, so they took us along. One morning, early in the morning, must have been September, because here it was a rush. The Germans came in with trucks, a lot of them, and it was a rush to take everything off the fields and put them on those trucks for Germany. And one morning, they woke us up, and they took us deeper in Poland. That was not the Dead March yet. That was not. They took us on trains to Auschwitz. I thought we were going to avoid this camp, but no. But we had food, we had things, and when we came on the station in Auschwitz, I saw all my friends that I left, not all of them, A lot of them were dead already, but some of my friends that I left in Bleaching, they looked terrible because they were after the yellow fever, the typhus, and I shared food with them. And they tattooed my arm.
Could we see the tattoo?
Yes.
And can you read the number?
It's 15401.
Okay.
This is when they do the...
All right.
Okay.
Yes.
I was there for about 2 weeks, and every day there was a sailor pearl, and every day they sent people to the gas chambers because they were skinny or they had anything on the body. Because I looked so good, one day they sent us on a transport to a ammunition factory, a whole group, mostly the people that came from Sucha. They took us on trucks about 30 miles from Auschwitz to a place called Hindenburg. It's in Schlesia.
Silesia. Silesia?
Yeah, Silesia, yeah. They took us there. They built that camp specially for the workers. The camp was just about a mile and a half from the factory where they made the shells to grenades. The leader of that camp, they sent in somebody from Auschwitz. His name was Taylor. He was sadist. He was a terrible tyrant. It's a matter of fact, as after the war, they hanged him. He was an unbelievable bad man. We worked 12 hours a day. From the morning, from 6 in the morning to 6 at night, from 6 at night to 6 in the morning. I worked by the oven that melted the iron. We had like a formula. This how many pounds of this iron, so many pounds of this iron. The iron was melted by 1,500 degrees. Now here was the oven and here was the door. So it was cold and hot. It was so dusty that the German that watched us, they had to use vacuum cleaners a couple of times a day, so much dust, but nothing for us.
They took it off themselves?
Off themselves. Some little vacuum cleaners that they dusted them off the... We worked there, Jewish girls, women, and French prisoners of war. And some very, very old Germans, because they mobilized already everybody. Nobody was there to work. That's what it was. That's what we came to work there. One day, I went to the bathroom. It was very hot, and I unbuttoned just one button of my overalls. And the assessman came over to me. He says, "Why did you unbutton your coat?" I said, "It was hot." And he hit me so hard in my ear that I had ringing in my ear for a while.
How did he hit you? With his hand or?
With his arm, with his open hand. With his open hand, he just hit me over my head. You couldn't say nothing. You had to go back, stay down, work. One day, a little later, I got, because of the cold, it was already that time, winter, it was from the door, I had an infection in my bladder, I couldn't urinate. And we had in that camp a little hospital, just about, I would say, bunk beds, how many were they, let's see, maybe about four on both sides. Maybe 10 people, maybe 8, can't remember exactly. The doctor of this hospital was a Yugoslavian woman. I don't know if she was Jewish, if she was just Yugoslavian. I don't know until today. All I know, she had that Tyler that was such a tyrant. She had a lot, he liked her very much. And she took me to the hospital even if I didn't have no temperature, because usually they took him with temperature. And she gave me, she had some medicine. Why? Because they needed us to work. So they brought medicines in for us. She gave me medicine, and I took the medicine. I stayed in the hospital for a day or two. One day, there was a young Jewish woman. She had some kind of a surgery, some kind of a tumor and she was operating on her without anesthetics. And all of a sudden, there were three Germans that came in, and they says, one of them was Mengele's. I find out later that I didn't know who Mengele's was, but that Yugoslavian doctor told me who it was. And when he just came in, when she was screaming, like screaming, imagine cutting your body with no anything. So imagine the screams what she had. And he said, why is she screaming so? And all I know that he left after maybe 20 minutes, a half an hour, he left. And she told me, and another friend that lives in my building, Fania, and she says to me, you both go in your barracks. Don't ask anything. The next morning when we get up, there was nobody in the hospital, and all the gypsies, they took out.
This is tape four. Today is November 13th, 1995. I'm interviewing Barbara Schubak. My name is Mildred Gelfand. This is Brooklyn, New York, USA. The language is English. We were talking about your being saved by the Yugoslavian woman doctor.
Right.
Is there another incident?
Yes, another incident. Mm-hmm. Because we were so valuable, because we had to go every day to work, and we really did some work there. Some girls complained maybe of toothache, so they send in two German dentists. I don't know if they were dentists, probably no dentists at all. They had to go in, and every one of us had to open their mouth and check our teeth. If they found the littlest cavity that was so small that today probably a dentist wouldn't even bother to do anything, would wait until he got a big cavity there. I had a mouth with very nice, healthy teeth. And when it came to me, all I know that they pulled two of my good teeth. No medicines, no painkillers. All I know when they started pulling that I got up from the chair, as they were pulling, I just pulled myself up with my body from my chair. So one of the men just stayed there behind me on my shoulders and pushed me down on my chair. I was bleeding, there was nothing, just a little water to rinse my mouth.
And then what happened after that?
After this, when we find out all the gypsies and the whole hospital was taken. We still worked there. And again, we heard the rumors in the place from the French prisoners of war that the Germans, the Russians, are on our backs. One day, that was already 19, let's see, it was at the end of 44. Must have been in December 1944, in December. That when the Death March began. One morning.
Did you suffer any injuries before the Death March?
Yes, I was going to tell you, I forgot about this. In that factory, I fell on a piece of hot iron. The iron was made, the shells were made first from like a sand, moles. And in that mold, the iron was poured in, that hot iron. And then they took it out from the mold, and the hot shells for the grenades were just laying around. Sometimes it wasn't formed right. And I fell on a hot disc kind of iron, and it ripped my knee. No blood came out, just some white thing. Was no medicine, all they had was paper. My wound was open for the longest time. I couldn't walk. With that wound is when the death march began. All we took was those striped uniforms, and they let us take some blankets, thin, that we covered ourselves, very thin blankets. Now imagine that was December. It's below zero in Poland by that time. We marched, no food, no nothing. Whoever couldn't walk was shot. We walked for miles and miles and days, a couple of days. And until we thought for sure, at night we didn't walk. They were afraid of the, I was the opposite. I think we walked at night most of the time. And we were hidden in the daytime because they were afraid of the Russians. They took us on trucks. Open trucks where the snow and the rain was pouring all over us. We were eating snow, there was no food. We passed through the Sudeten in Czechoslovakia, and the people, the Czechs, threw some of their lunches on our trains. And they kept saying in their own language, the war will be over soon. I got a cold on my vocal cords and I couldn't speak for a couple of months. Very hoarse. They took us later on, they took us to a certain place and they put us in trains, closed trains. The train was from some kind of a chemical that they made.
Lead.
They make I forgot what it's called, the pencils, the lye, what is
lead.
It?
Lead.
Lead was black. It was a terrible train. When we came out from that train, about a day later, we were all black. They took us to a place. We know for sure that was already the end. How much more could they do? How much more could we go? It wasn't the end yet. They took us a place. The name was Bergen-Belsen.
When did you get there? When did you arrive?
We got there beginning of January 1945. Came there. It was dark, it was wet, it was an unbelievable place. Bodies were laying around already that time on the ground. And we were waiting. We didn't know that they didn't have no gas chambers there. We didn't know because it was closed already. All we knew that we're going to be there, we're going to go there to the gas chambers. But again, if you have years, you survive. You go out of everything if God gives you years. This is what I'm not going to say about everybody, I'm going to talk about me. All of a sudden I turn around and here I see my friends that I left in Auschwitz. They were there before us. And usually they used to tell you which block to go, where to stay. But it was already such a terrible place, and the Germans themselves knew it was the end, that they didn't care what it was. There was no more food, there was no more nothing. So my friends that had a little place already, we had to sleep. They took me in. We were 10 girls, and if you had to turn around, the whole group had to turn. They gave me some clothes that I made from old clothes that I found in the place from people that died, from people from transport that came, and we covered ourselves, and we took care of each other, and we put our heads on our laps and took the lice out of their heads. And whatever we find in food, rotten potatoes, rotten carrots, we shared. And if somebody finds some soup from somebody that didn't need that was sick, we shared. All we wanted was to survive, because we knew ourselves. Unless they're going to shoot us up, what we thought, they're going to take us all before the war's end, they're going to shoot us and bury us. This is what we thought. And we thought, oh, what a pity it's going to be if we don't make it. What a pity is it going to be if we don't make it. And we heard a cannon from far. After a couple of months, we heard a cannon. And we knew the end was near, but how do you make it to the end? How do you survive without food? We were lucky enough, us, the Bialystoker girls, that we had a typhus fever so much before, when our bodies was not as bad as it then, because the less transfer that came from the Romanian, Hungarian Jews, they all died. They couldn't take that change. The typhus fever has something that the weaker you are, as big as you are, you could maybe survive. But if you're very strong, it's too much of a contrast. They died out in the thousands. Now, one day, after listening to the cannons, we hear a panzer dragon coming through the camp, and all kind of languages in Jewish and Polish and Russian. In Russian, we had Russians in Bergen-Belsen, men, that became cannibals. They ate each other.
How do you know that?
Oh, everybody knew about it.
Did you see that?
I didn't see it, but everybody was talking about it. Everybody was talking about it. And us, the group of the Bialystoker, I think we should be very proud of ourselves, because we were very good to each other, and we stayed. There's nobody to say that we did anything wrong. Until today, when I go someplace and I find some people, and I said, God was good to me that I didn't become an animal, that I stayed good, decent. Some people come to me, oh, Buba, you were so good in concentration camp. You helped me this, you did this with me, this, that. I'm so glad for my children, for my family, that I don't have to be ashamed that I didn't become, because I don't blame those people that became cop or something, because it was so bad. When it comes to fight for your life or existence, you'll do anything. But go back to the other stuff. When that tank and he said, don't be afraid, the Germans can do nothing to you. We cannot come to the camp because of the yellow fever, of the typhus. We cannot come. But they cannot do anything to you.
And who told you that?
That the people in that panzer wagon. Okay. This is what they said to us. And the Germans right away put on white armbands. And they were not seen. So the German soldiers stayed in the, not the soldier, the SS, stayed about, I would say, a half a mile from us, maybe less than that. They did not stay with us because where we stayed was dead, was dirt, was sicknesses, was lice, everything bad. They couldn't stay there. They stayed separate quarters. As we knew already, we are liberated. We're not going to die now. But we were hungry. There was no food no more. They didn't give us anything no more. As before, we had a little bit of bread. We had a little bit of soup that when you finished eating, there was sand on the bottom. But at least you had something. There was no more nothing. So me and another friend said, look, we're going to go out and look for food. We're going to go to the German quarters there. We'll die here from hunger. At least we're going to do something. So we went over there, and I went into their rooms and started looking in the closets. Those were the German SS. Some of them ran away, but some of them stayed, because the army, the British army, was already around us. They couldn't run away too far. And I saw a briefcase. And in that briefcase was bread, was some kind of a German salami, it was condensed milk. I didn't know, I took the briefcase and I started running. As I started out going to us, to our place there, I heard him saying in German, give me my briefcase, give me my Natasha. It's called give me my Natasha. Why I'm gonna shoot? He had a rifle, they still had the ammunition because as I said, the British Army did not go in there. But they figured the Germans are not gonna take chances on shooting us because they were all around them. But he said, I'm gonna shoot if you're not gonna give me my Natasha, my briefcase. We didn't answer him. He said, 1, 2, 3. We were running like crazy. We brought the food home to the girls. And what do you think happened? We ate that stuff and we all got sick with terrible diarrhea. By that time already, I think a couple of days later, the British did come in. They were wearing this kind of yellow uniform to protect themselves, like on their faces. And they came with, and we said to ourselves, when they're gonna come, they're gonna give us a bed and they're gonna give us clean clothes. We get rid of the lice. They sprayed us with DDT, some kind of white powder, but the lice disappeared. That was true. And they gave us medicine for the diarrhea. And in a couple of days later, they took us on trucks and they took us to the quarters where the SS was in Belsen. That was Bergen-Belsen. That must have been like, I would say about a half an hour away from that dirty camp.
What date was that?
That was May, it was later already because we were liberated when they came in. It was May 23rd, I think 23rd, 1945. And when they took us to that clean camp, must have been a couple of days, or maybe a week later. They took the rooms away from the German women, from the SS, and they gave us rooms. Now, you need clothes, we didn't have anything to wear. It was all the dirty that we'd made ourselves. We found some Canadian soldiers. It was already May, and we were wandering around there in that camp. It was clean, had clean water. But still, we didn't have enough food. But it was enough food to eat. So some Canadian and British soldiers came by and they said, you have nothing to wear. We took away all the clothes from the German woman from the SS. And we have it here in a big place. It's curfew, you're not allowed to go. But we're gonna stay that time. Me and my friend, they were Jewish Canadians. We're gonna watch, we want you to come middle of the night. We're gonna let you into that place and get yourself some clothes. And this is what we did. We took clothes and we made ourselves, for the first time in so many years, we took bedding, sheets and pillowcases, and we slept on clean pillowcases and sheets.
How long did you stay in Belsen?
We stayed in Belsen for a while. Now let's see, that was, the month was May. May, June, July, August, September. By that time, a lot of people that were liberated, like my husband, I'll talk about my husband. He was liberated in Buchenwald from the American Eisenhower. And they were free, so he came to a town on the American zone named Bamberg. It's in Bayern. And he got an apartment with some friends, and then they said, they find out that some Bialystoker people, women, are in Bergen in Belsen.
He was from Bialystok.
Yeah, he was from Bialystok too. And I knew my husband from seeing in the street in Bialystok. It's a matter of fact, after the dead walk, when we stayed in the Sudeten, I saw across, like on the other side, I saw him and I remembered him. But going back to Bergen-Belsen, so they came to look for Bialystoker family. They looked for sisters. Nobody knew what happened. So you find that his cousin was with me. Her name was Lisa. She passed away. And he was very happy to see her. She was happy to see him. And he said to us like this, "What are you staying here in the camp yet? Why don't you come with us to the American zone? We have the Americans took away apartments from the Nazis, the apartments. We have food that you could go and get yourself. There are some cards, some coupons. You could get some clothes and coupons. And you're still waiting in line for a little bit of food that the British Army didn't have too much themselves." And it took us and our cousin Lisa to the American side, the American zone. We traveled a long time because the tracks were all bombed. So you walked a little bit and you drove a little bit. And so finally we made it to that Bamberg. Bamberg was a town in Bayern, as I said. And they did not feel anything in the war. It was not bombed. And we stayed in Bamberg. He got me a room for me and my friend. And he stayed with men also from Bialystok, but he cared. All the food he brought us, he took care of me for clothes and shelter and everything. And we started going together and we fell in love. It was mostly of a need. He didn't have anybody, I didn't have anybody. I had my two sisters, but they were far away. One was in Argentina that we left before the war, and a sister in South Africa that left much in the 30s before the war. So in the meantime, we had each other, and we got married in 1946. It was just 49 years that we are married.
What's your husband's name?
My husband's name is William.
And then you lived together in Bamberg?
We got married, and we lived together in Bamberg until 1949, lived in Bamberg. And then I got a little girl.
Your daughter was born?
My daughter was born on May 8th, on the day of Israel's independence, 1948. And we were trying to leave Germany, but wherever we wanted to go, there was no place. I wanted to go to my sister's, because I wanted to have somebody. But because of the governments, Perón was in Argentina. He was a fascist. He didn't want any Jews in. South Africa had another fascist, Smith. He didn't let no Jewish people in. So my sister tried to get me a visa to go to Uruguay and then be smuggled into Argentina. In the meantime, my husband came and he said, "You know what? I heard they're registering for United States." I says, "United States? I know my friends with family in United States. I'd send them out papers, and they're still waiting. Who are we going to go to United States?" He says, "This is what I'm telling you." I says, "Them, you know what? Register. We registered any place that opened that wanted us. We wanted badly to get away from Germany." I'm going to tell you something, that the same week that we got called to go to United States, I also got a letter from embassy in Belgium. Because to go to Argentina or go to Uruguay, I had to go to Belgium. From Belgium to Uruguay, from Uruguay to Argentina. So a friend of mine that was already in the United States, and I said, "What shall I do?" And she said to me, "Listen, if you from United States, you could go any place you want to go. But from other places to come to United States, it's a little bit harder." So we decided to go to United States. And because my husband was an automobile mechanic, because he worked for the Germans in the ghetto, by the Gestapo, he worked for them. And he learned the trade. So when they ask you, "What do you do what is your trade?" We put on automobile mechanic. So they send us, according to your trade, like, let's see, a tailor would go to New York, a carpenter would go to Tennessee, us, they send to Detroit, Michigan, because of the auto industry. Then we came to New York Harbor. Friends of ours was by the port. And when I told them, we're going to Detroit, Michigan, I said, where are you going to go to Detroit? Who do you know in Detroit, Michigan? What if you get sick? What if you need help? This is a free country. This is the first time I heard of a free country. This is a free country. You stay, you go wherever you want to go. But the people from the joint that made sure that I have my husband has a job and I have an apartment in Detroit, Michigan, said, look, again, this is a free country. You could do whatever you want to do, but you get not help from us. And that was it. So a friend of mine, my friend Ray, she had an apartment in Lower East Side, and she says, don't worry. She was the only one that had her own apartment. The rest of them had just rooms. And she said to me, you stay with me until we get to someplace. So my husband and my little girl, she was a year and a half old.
What's your daughter's name?
Sandy. We call her Sandy. Her name is Sandra. She's named after my mother, Shaney. Mm-hmm. So she was a year and a half old, and we stayed with my friend. She lived on the Lower East Side. And we lived in the kitchen on our couch with mice all around because the pushcart was all outside. And I was very depressed because my husband, what is he going to do? Where are we going to get money? There's no money, there's no language, there's no nothing. So a neighbor of my friend was a taxi driver, and he said, what are you worrying about? Your husband knows how to fix cars. I'll take him to my place. And he took him the next day to his place, and my husband worked there for 8 years.
What day did you come to America?
It was October the 12th, 1949, and the boat Stuart.
And then your husband worked as an auto mechanic?
Mechanic for 8 years.
And what happened after that?
Well, he worked in that place for 8 years. He had a lot of problems there because it was a different kind of work. It was piece work there. And you had to go to ask for every part, you had to know the name. And let's see, for this kind of work, you got a dollar. For other things you did, you have more money. The guy, there was one guy, you had to write on every day you work. There was one man that used to write up his work. And we didn't know if it was good or it was bad. He got his money every week. I remember it was $20 or $25, whatever it was. And one day, a man came over to me, he was Italian, and he said to him, you know, like in almost in sound language, and he said to him, listen, this man is doing you no good, because he's writing down all the better things for himself and all the cheap things that you that is made for him, for you. From now on, I'll do it for you. And we became very good friends with him. Jerry was his name. I don't know what happened to him. And we worked for 8 years on this place. Finally, it was only fixing taxi cabs. And one day, the company broke up, and everybody went like individual. But one day, a man came over. A chassid, he was a religious man. And my husband was under the cars, and he said to him, are you Jewish? He said, yes. Is your work in this kind of work? He says, yes. You know what? Why don't you buy yourself a cab, a taxi? And he helped us. And this is what we did. And my husband was a cab driver for 30-some odd years. And we raised a beautiful family.
You have other children?
I have a son, Stephen. He's a CPA. He's got two children on his own. My daughter has two sons. Both. One is in college. One is graduating college next year, and very good family, very good friends, and we have a beautiful life together. And God was good to us all those years.
Did you do any work yourself?
I worked, yes. I worked for 24 years. I worked in a department store as a sales lady. When I went to work, I really didn't need the money too much, but I wanted to be occupied. I knew that just sitting It's not going to do me any good, because I was depressed. I felt because I was in concentration camp, maybe I feel this way. But when I came to work, it did a lot of good to me. I saw that people, even if they were not there, also have their anxieties, also have their pains. And it taught me a lot. I got to know people from different races and different beliefs. And I find out that what happened to me lately, all right, they didn't go to concentration camp, but my pains and my feelings could come also to other people have them that are not there. Maybe mine is a little even deeper. That's about
This is tape 5. Today is November 13th, 1995. I'm interviewing Barbara Schubak. My name is Mildred Gelfand. This is Brooklyn, New York, USA. The language is English. Before we stop, I want to ask you two more questions. Could you discuss the Holocaust effects on you, both physically and emotionally?
Well, what the Holocaust did to me, first of all, robbed me of my heritage, of my family. Imagine how many children, how many nieces and nephews I would have had. Imagine what kind of family my children would have had. They had no grandparents, they had no aunts, no uncles. A lot of times they had to, as much as I tried, to be, not to show my insecurities, but I do have them. If a child gets sick, it's not just a cold. It's the biggest thing, because I'm so afraid of losing. This is what the Holocaust does. If I had sisters, brothers, maybe they would share a little bit of my emotions, but everything is into my children and to my husband. I'm always afraid. I became very insecure, not with any material things, but with their lives. I worry about my grandchildren, their marks in school. I worry about their lives, what they're gonna have now. I worry, this is what I think the Holocaust did to me, and insecurity. They robbed me, the Holocaust robbed me of my everything. Of my whole family.
Did your insecurities have an effect on your children?
Yes.
Could you talk about that?
Well, because they, as I see my daughter now with her children, I have a daughter-in-law that is American born, her parents are American born. I have my son-in-law that his parents are American born. And I see the difference between my daughter and my daughter-in-law. Somehow they are much easier. They don't take life as hard as my daughter does, as my son does. I see the difference between those two. And this is what I think it's for me, as much as I tried a lifetime not to show it to them. My son used to come late and I used to wait up. And the minute I heard him, I used to go into bed. I didn't want him to know that I'm sitting up, that I'm waiting. Where are you going? What do you do? I used to tell him, please, Stephen, when you go out, call me. Ma, nobody calls the mother. I used to say, tell them you have a sick mother. You have to call them. This is what the Holocaust did to me. And I think this is what the children have a little bit too. Mine are not as bad as other ones, but it is. I'm 100% sure. Even my daughter says to me, Ma, I'm like you. I'm afraid if he goes, if he comes, and what he does.
Now that more than 50 years have passed since the end of the Holocaust, the end of the war, what message do you have for your children, your grandchildren, and the world?
Well, the world, I'm not going to say, I'm not as smart. Smarter people than me could not say anything to the world. But I'll say to my children, just be decent. Just don't forget that you're Jews. Have a good life. Try to be happy. Try to raise your children as good Jews. That's all I could say to the world. Don't hate us. We are wonderful people, the Jewish people. We are smart. We did a lot of things for the world. Give us back something. Don't hate us. That's it.
Thank you, Barbara.
Thank you.
Barbara?
Yes.
Can you introduce your husband?
Yes, this is my husband, William. We call him Bill. And we're married for 49 years. And he's good. He's a good husband. If I have to do it all over again, I would do it. And what else can I say?
Bill, what would you like to say?
She's a wonderful woman. Good looking woman. She's good to me. What else? She's the best.
And how would you describe your life together?
Wonderful. Very happy.
I understand that you were a survivor too.
Yes.
And you chose not to go through with this for yourself because it was difficult.
Yeah.
Could you talk a little bit about your children?
I got very good children. I'm very happy. They're very close to me. I got good grandchildren. What else? I got a good wife. So I'm a happy fella.
Anything else, Barbara? Any other comments?
It's really nothing more to say. I think I said everything that I could say. Okay. It was a bad war, but as I said before, life was good to me. God was good to me. I believe deeply in God. I go to the synagogue every Saturday, and I believe very deeply that if God gives you years, you could survive. And believe, right now, we pray for our health and the health of my children. And should be peace in Israel right now, which we love. And there's not too much. I don't ask too much. Never ask too much. Life was good. Good to be alive after all that. Sometimes when I go into the house and it's warm, when it's cold outside and I come in, not so warm, and I said, oh, how good it is that we don't have to stay in a zelt in the cold. When I see there's so much food to eat, oh my God, it's so good that I'm not hungry anymore. I still do that. I still remember those days. And that's all I could say. That's it.
Any comments from you? Last comments.
It's the same thing. It's the same thing. I'm a happy girl. I'm a happy fella.
Well, thank you for letting me come into your life.
Thank you for coming. Because this is our duty, I think, of every survivor, to leave something for generations to come, that they knew, they don't know what happened to us. We're reading now about Spanish Inquisition. That was even worse. So I'm glad I did it, and thank you very much for coming.
Thank you.
Welcome.
This is my mother, Shana. She was born in Bialystok, and she was killed in the war. And that picture was taken probably about, I don't know exactly the year, but I would say in 20s, 1920.
How old do you think she was?
By that time, and that picture I would say she's about 40.
Anything else about the picture?
I really don't know too much about this. This is the house where I was born. And the house was there before I was born. My father built it probably many years ago. I think that house must be over 100 years old now. This picture was taken about 6 years ago when I was in Poland, in Białystok. And the house looks like the day I left. Nothing changed. Some of my Polish neighbors live there. And I can't get it now, because it would go into a lot of trouble, so it's there.
What was your reaction when you saw the house?
When I saw the house, that was the most emotional feeling in all my life. I was emotional feeling when we were liberated, when I got married, when I had my children. But when I saw that house, some kind of a feeling that I never thought I could have. I mean, you go inside and there's an oven that's in the middle of the room that warms three rooms, and the oven is still there. And you think your family's gonna come down and they could warm themselves by the oven, but it's not. Downstairs where you see the two windows was my brother. Upstairs was my mother and me and my sister. It was beautiful. It was beautiful. Here you see the shutters around the window. I remember when I used to come home as a young girl with a friend, a boyfriend. And we used to talk, and my brother used to open the window and said to me, "It's enough. Go in the house." Nothing changed there, like everything was the way we left. Nothing inside. Maybe it's a little shabby looking now, but inside was all the same, the oven. It was a terrible feeling. Nobody would come to see, to come out to warm themselves by the oven. All I could say, the house is there, but the people are not.
Okay.
This is my mother in the middle and my two stepsisters. And they are by the grave of their mother, which was my mother's sister.
What was your mother's sister's name?
Hannah Rischke. Two names she had. This is my sister, Fruma.
Which is Fruma?
The one on the right of me, and the other one is Mashka. We call them Mashka. And they are at the grave of their mother, which is my mother's sister.
When was that taken?
Must have been taken 1936, 35, before the war. Before the war. My sister on this side was the most beautiful woman in Białystok. Most beautiful woman. Sad.
Okay.
Those are my niece and my nephew. These are the children of my sister, Mashke, the one that you just saw at the cemetery. The two beautiful children.
What were their names?
Esther and Samuel. Shmuel is a name after my father. Gorgeous two children.
And what happened to them?
They got killed with their mother and father. They went to Treblinka. This is a picture of my sister from the one that you saw on the other side of the cemetery, with her family, her husband, and her three children.
What were their names? Her husband's name?
Her husband's name, Chaim Yossel. And the two girls was Hannah and Sonia and Shmuel, after my father. Everybody had a name after my father.
When was this taken?
It was taken in early 30s.
In Bialystok?
In Bialystok, yes.
Okay.
This is a picture of a class, school class, where my younger sister, Hannah, went to. With a school. So I got, that's the only picture I have from her. She was young.
How old was Hannah there?
She's here, she must be about 10 years old.
And where was this picture taken?
It was taken in Bialystok, in the school where she went to.
And where is Hannah on the picture?
There is an arrow by her. This is a picture of the big synagogue in our town. You could still see the dome. If you look there, you see dome like on top. It was burned with the people, with about 1,500 beautiful men inside. You could see the ashes. You could see the people standing there picking out the bones to bury. That was the first day the Germans came into our town. The fire could be seen for miles and miles around in the whole town. This is what it's left. Right now, this is right after the fire. As I said before, those people are picking out the bones to bury in the cemetery.
What day was that?
That was June 1941. I cannot tell you exactly the date. But it was the day they marched in.
Where did you get that picture?
I got a picture from somebody that sent me from Bialystok. Partisans lived to the war in the woods. They gave me the picture. This is a picture, like a little monument on a side where the synagogue used to be. This is where they put up. It's in Jewish and it's Polish. If you want me to read it to you, I could read it, what it says.
Mm-hmm.
Can I take it a little bit?
Yes.
Yeah. This, dem lichtigen Gondeng von 3000 Kedoshim verbrannt in der größeren Schul durch die hitleristische Mörders. Juni. Den 24.1941. This is a plot that belongs really to that synagogue that burned. And I made a little mistake. There are 3,000 men that was burned, not 1,500. That was my mistake, because I read it now. This is what it put down by the Jewish few people that are living in Bialystok. This is a picture of me taken in 1945, right after the war. I think it was taken in Belsen. My husband, before we were married, he got me that sweater that I'm wearing. There's nothing else to say about this. It's just right after the war. This is a picture was taken, I think, in 1946. Before we got married, when we were young.
Who was on that picture?
And that picture is me and my husband.
How old were you at the time?
Probably about 20.
And your husband?
My husband is 4 years older than me.
Yeah.
So he was 24.
And your husband's name?
My husband's name is William. We call him Bill.
And where was this taken?
In Bamberg, Germany. This is a picture of me, my husband, and my cousin, the one that the Germans told to hide. He was sent from Buchenwald as a child to Switzerland, and he came from Switzerland to Germany in Bamberg to visit us, and this is the picture.
What is his name?
His name is Mike, the second name is Briska.
And where is Mike now?
Mike is now in Florida.
And how old is he?
He must be in his middle 60s.
And this was taken in Bamberg?
This was taken in Bamberg. He came to visit us from Switzerland. This is a picture of my husband as a child, his sister, younger sister, his father and his mother.
Could you give us the names?
The name of the father is Shepsel. The name of them of his mother was Rosa. This is my husband, Bill, and his little sister. I forgot her name, Bill. Huh?
Sarah.
And where was this taken?
In Bialystok.
Do you know when, about when?
Probably, in the 20s, 1925. No, not 1925.
Yes.
Bill, when was it taken? No, it couldn't be.
I was 4 or 5 years old.
Oh, that's it. 1926.
1926, okay.
Yeah. Well, this is my family. My husband and me. I have my daughter, Sandy, and her husband, Robert, and her son, Russell, and her younger son, Brian. Then I have my son, Stephen, and my daughter-in-law, Natalie, and her, their two sons, Russ and Brian. It was my son's Russ bar mitzvah when the picture was taken.
When was that?
It was 2 years ago, and it was taken in Staten Island, where the bar mitzvah was taking place.